Good afternoon. Welcome everybody to the second in this series of the Norton live streams. If you missed the first one we held this morning, it will be on our YouTube channel, the EMEA Norton YouTube channel, which you can go and have a look at that, and it'll be uploaded in the next couple of days. For those who attended that, thanks very much and welcome back again. And for those people who, if this is your first session, welcome also. Okay, as stated, we're doing a series of live streams over the next few months until December, six in total. Two, obviously, today. There'll be another two at the beginning of November on the 5th, and then the final two will be on the 3rd of December. So you'll get your invite sent out for these. So please, if you like what you saw today, click and join these. There'll be lots more information about new products and different solutions we have for various markets in these upcoming streams. So a little bit of guidance on how the subtitles will work, because obviously this session is going to be in the English language, but there are subtitles available for you if you didn't see the message at the beginning of the live stream to say how to find the subtitles. Go onto the bottom bar of your screen that you view. There'll be a small icon, like a little cog, like a gear. That will be your settings menu. You can see once you click on that button, there's an option for subtitles. If you click on that, you can then choose the language that you want to display. Only six languages available at the moment, but hopefully that will change in the future as teams gets better. Okay, so this afternoon, let's have a look at the agenda and what topic we're talking about today. It is weld removal to a mirror finish in 4 easy steps. Wow, that sounds like a challenge, but let's see if we're up to it today. First of all, we're going to intro the experts. After that, we're going to be looking at choosing the right abrasives for each step, a really important part of this application, this process. We're going to be looking at the unique attributes of all of the products we're looking at today. A couple of tips or a few tips on best practice as we use them, machine speed, all sorts of things like that. And then right at the very end, there will be a live questions and answers session for us all where you can pose questions to us. So as we're going through the live streams, please pop your questions into the questions panel on the right hand side of your screen. You may not see the question appear straight away. It has to go to our moderators who check for anything silly going on and make sure that the questions are actually valid and useful for everybody. Pop your questions in there, and then we'll all come as a group at the end and answer the questions together, because it's good that everybody hears the answers to these. Okay, so first of all, I think it's a good idea we introduce who's going to be speaking on today's live stream. And of course, first of all, it's me. My name's Paul Gray. I'm an application engineer for Sangaban and Norton for the MRO market for EMEA. So that's the maintenance and repair operations for basically the whole of Europe, Middle East and Africa. I live in Cheshire, right in the middle of England, beautiful part of the country. 30 years I've spent in manufacturing since I was the age of 16. I know, 46, you would not believe it that I'm that age, but it's true. And 18 years of these have been spent working with abrasives. So yeah, really lucky to be in this position. Okay, my colleague with us today is a very handsome chap from Glasgow in Scotland. Is Mr. Robin Cook. He's a senior product manager for non-wovens for EMEA. So again, same area as myself. He's also the non-woven global platform manager, which is a big part of Robin's responsibility. And he trumps me on the years of experience, 31 years in the industry. So we're very experienced man we've got with us here today. Hey, Robin, how are you doing?
Good afternoon, Paul. Doing well. Thank you. And hello to everyone.
All right. Thanks for that, Robin. OK, so first of all, before we get into the grinding, we're going to be spending most of the hour today really on the tools rather than me talking, which is, I think, you're probably quite thankful for, and certainly I am as well, and everybody else in this room. So always good. But I just wanted to go through each of the step. I'm going to go through step 1, 2, 3 and 4, but I'm only going to go through each step before we do the actual application. So we'll discuss, or I'll tell you what we're going to do and what product we're going to use, and then we'll perform the application. Then we'll go back to another PowerPoint screen and do the second application. So we should really get down to it, I think. First of all, what I want to show you is what we're trying to achieve today, where we're going to start and where we're going to finish. So here is the component we're going to be working on today. It's a Norton N. Okay, so N for Norton. So this is some box section stainless steel that's been welded together to form a nice N shape. Obviously, you can see you've still got some mill scale on here. I got the pattern from the mill rollers. You've got the weld seam on this side here, where they welded the box section together. And also some TIG welds here, which are, you know, burnt and blue. And what we want to do, we're starting with that, but the finished result we actually want to get is this. Okay, so a polished surface. You know, it's never going to be perfect when you're using a hand tool like an angle grinder, but I can sure you can see the sheen that we're getting from that is pretty good. And if you're able to do that with an angle grinder in four steps, it can come in pretty handy, to be honest with you. So yeah, really nice finish off that. I could even shave my beard with that, but not that I ever do. But yeah, so that's what we're going to do. So first of all, we might as well move on and have a quick look at step one. Martin, slide please, my friend. Yeah, Martin, if you hear me referring to Martin during this stream, it's my colleague Martin Greswold, who's on controlling all of the cameras and all of the audio for today. So if anything goes wrong, we can blame him. But otherwise, you know who I'm referring to now. So step one is obviously going to be weld removal. The first one is we need to get rid of that TIG weld that we've got on the surface there. So this one is quite a crucial step to the application. If we get this wrong, it can affect everything we do from here on out, and the end result that we have. It's really important to get this one right. So we'll have a look at what products we can use for weld removal, what products we can't use for weld removal. That's more applicable to this. And again, what grit to use and why are we using that that grit size rather than something else? And just if you look at the top pictures on the right hand side of your screen, we're talking about finishing something to a polish here, remember. So you look at the finish we have from a grinding disc on the left hand side versus the finish we've got from a fiber disc. Similar grit sizes, but completely different finish. All right, so that's sort of getting you towards what we're trying to achieve here, you know, not making a mistake in that first step. Right, so I think we're ready to start. So I'm going to get our unfinished component into my vise, tighten it up, make sure it's in the right place for Martin with his cameras there. Okay, and then I'm going to get some PPE on. I've got an ear plug in here, which is obviously taking away a lot of the noise, and I'm going to put another one in that side too. I've got my safety boots on, my flame retardant overalls, gloves, heat-proof gloves as well, again with a leather palm. So when I'm handling this component, which will get quite hot during the application, there's no chance of me having the heat transfer through my gloves to my hands, keeping me nice and safe, no burning. And then last of all, a face shield. Okay, so I'm getting my face shield on, so any debris or sparks or whatever come off from here, there's no chance of going into my eyes. I'm not going to wear a face mask for this session today due to the fact I'm conversing with you. It will make it very difficult and more time consuming to do it, but we do have good extraction around me, so don't worry about me. I'm safe. Okay. Right, so weld removal. So let's get a few products over here. So again, two different things we can use for weld removal really is what we have in front of us here. I mean, we can use a conventional grinding disc. This is actually one of our very new innovations, to be honest with you. This is our LCG, which is our light comfort grinding wheel. It's actually a 3mm thick dedicated grinding wheel. Really nice product, which we'll be launching on one of our live streams coming, I think, in the 5th of November. So please join there to find a bit more about this product. Yeah, certainly we can take off the weld with a conventional grinding disc, but go back to the picture we were looking at earlier. It will leave a really rough finish, and I will finish a part of the component with this so we can have a look later at whether we were successful or not to take out the scratches from that. We could use flat disc, okay? Like this one here. This is our easy trim flat disc, a trimmable flat disc that we have in our range. And again, yeah, it's possible to use this. This is a grit 40, probably a bit aggressive again. It's not going to be as aggressive as the grinding disc that you were just showing earlier, but it certainly will dig some great holes in there. We could think about using maybe a grit 60 or a grit 80, but with a flat disc, it's very hard. Okay, yes, you've got a nice angle on here for when you're grinding on a flat surface, but it's quite a hard product, and it's very easy to damage the surface or gouge into the surface with that, because of the sort of basically circular aspect of it. If you're grinding at 15 degrees, you're going to put a groove inside the material. Okay, so yes, it will do the job much better than the grinding disc, but to be honest, I want something with a bit more flexibility. And that's where I'm turning to a fibre disc like this, because we have more flexibility in this product. It actually does move. So when I'm using this on the surface, it's going to give me a larger footprint, or a flat footprint on the surface, and therefore not dig in as badly as the other products, the grinding disc and the flat disc. Really important as well, the flap disc is only as important as the backup pad we're using with it. So here I have two options with me today. We have this very flexible one made out of nylon, and we have also this more rubberized ribbed one. This is really hard. Okay, so for super stock removal, this is the product we're using. Okay, so if we're taking off lots of material, use that, because it's hard and stiff, will act very much like a flat disc. But today, again, like I said, I want some flexibility, so I'm going to use this this pad, which just has a bit of flex on there, so I can conform the edge of the fibre disc to the surface of the material a little bit better. One other thing as well about this product is his ceramic abrasive, okay, and I've chosen grit 80 today. You might think, well, you know, that's pretty fine, to be honest with you, but again, it's a ceramic product, it lasts long, it will do the work very well. But most importantly for this product, it's got an extra layer over the top of here called supersize. All right, so this is an extra layer we put on top of products like this, which are designed for stainless steel, to keep the surface cool, because this is one of the most difficult things to do with stainless steel when you're operating it, is to keep it cool. We dwell into too much in one area, it will burn. It's as simple as that. So this layer evaporates away, essentially taking the heat with it and keeping the grind area as cool as we can. Okay, so really very much designed for stainless steel. Grit 80 to reduce the chance of any damage. Right, enough talking. Let's get the product onto the angle grinder, and then we can start to get this surface looking something like. Whilst I'm operating, Robin will be it's like my compere in the background. He'll be commenting and describing what I'm doing as I'm doing it. Very difficult to me to grind and talk at the same time. I am a man. I'm not ambidextrous. I can only do one thing at a time. So Robin's going to help me out with that and explain to you what I'm doing as I'm grinding. So disc is on the grinder. I've taken the back flange off because I want the disc to sit inside the guard. If I leave the back flange from the machine on, it sits proud of the guard. Okay, so make sure you take the back flange off and you're well within the guarded area then. Okay, so on, welds off, and I'm also going to give a quick flash along the top of the surface of this box section steel as well, because there's a lot of heavy damage on here from handling marks and scratches and whatever else. So let's just give a quick buzz on here as well, just to get that nice and flat and in the same sort of order as where we get the weld. Okay, Robin, over to you.
Okay, Paul, thank you.
Turn him on.
So as Paul mentioned, we don't need to be too aggressive at the beginning. The first step in the process is very important. It has an impact on what happens in the next three steps. So the finish level that we get is determined by what you can see being worked on right now. So as Paul mentioned, he's chosen a disc which doesn't need to be overly aggressive. 80 grits enough to remove the welds and also give it this quick flash over the surface. And you can see that it's achieving it quickly enough without too much pressure. Also at the same time, it's creating a very good foundation for the next 2-3 steps that's going to come on the in the process. Again, the ceramic grain, the benefit of the ceramic grain cutting into that weld without, again, too much pressure, letting the disc and the weight of the machine do the work and achieving everything that we need to do in terms of stock removal at this point in time in the step. Again, the machine, the power tool that we've chosen here, is an everyday industrial tool available in the same kind of lines as most of the major power tool manufacturers. So nothing special about the tool. Just leaving a little bit of the welding area available, not completely finishing the weld. That can be done a little bit with the next step, the second step you'll see in the next sequence. But certainly, as we explained earlier, those grind lines are being created right now, and those need to be removed, which we'll see in the next subsequent steps. But that's the level we're at now in terms of the step one.
Yeah, thanks for that, Robin. So as you can see, struggling around these areas because when these parts were welded together, I think the fabricator didn't orientate the pieces of steel in the same orientation, i.e. the weld seam on the same place. Therefore, you get slightly different levels when they welded them together. That's part of fabrication. That's what you get, and that's what as a job as a finisher you have to try and correct. So it's to try and make the best possible case of what the component you've received in front of you. Well, that's one of the challenges of the job. Right, so bear in mind that we've put quite a bit of heat into here now. I can feel the heat radiating from this product. Okay, so so the weld's away. So now we can see what we've got is a particular scratch on the letter. I think you can see that in the camera. If I remember which way to look on the camera, they've changed. So yeah, you can see we've got a certain level of scratch on there. It looks nothing like the polished item that we're going to end up with later, but you see the P80 scratch. It's not too bad, but you can see a lot of directional marks from the fiber disc on there, or you know, in the different directions that I was grinding with the product. So really, we need something now to blend that away. So that brings us to I'm getting ahead of myself. I said earlier I was going to do a little grind with one of our grinding discs on the end of this stainless steel part, just so you can see the difference of how that grind looks as opposed to doing it with a fibre. So bear with me just 1 second. I'll change this disc over and I'll just do a quick grind with a conventional disc. Get the back flange back on.
So this comparison is going to show us the benefit of perhaps selecting the right abrasive product at the first step here. So what Paul's going to generate here is a more aggressive scratch pattern.
Yeah, that's right. I'm going to show you what happens when you don't choose the right product at the first step. So just going to do a quick grind on this one air. Very light pressure.
Again, it gets the job done, but you can already see the more aggressive scratch pattern.
Yeah, you definitely can. Right, let's power off while we change over. Okay, so we've got the welds away. We've taken the scale, the mill scale, off the surface. So time to have a look at the next stage in our process. Tidy these up, bit of housekeeping, bear with me. And that is blending, all right? So again, same products as we used this morning, but just a little bit more of a focus on it. We could use a variety of different products. We could use our our rapid prep discs, as we see in front of us here. We could use our rapid prep flap discs, which is essentially made of the same material, but many flaps of this surface conditioning material orientated into a disc. This is by far the cheapest product, whatever you pay for these, but it's very cheap but very quick to use. The life is not so long with these. This here with the flaps, so much more material to use on here compared to the surface conditioning disc. And I estimate, and well, we've done it in testing and results at customers, there's about 10 of these discs in this one disc. So it really is a good value for money, to be honest with you. So good, cheap, economical, long life product. Or my personal favorite is our Vortex Rapid Blend Unitised disc. A bit different. This is something different than you commonly see in the market. You see Unitised discs available from all sorts of different manufacturers these days, but of course I'm biased, but nothing compares to this product, I'm afraid. It really is something special. And that's thanks to the obviously the way it's constructed, but also our Vortex grain, which is a patented grain for Saint-Gobain. Nobody has access to this Vortex technology besides ourselves, and it's something really impressive. So all inside this this big meat of material on the back here is the Vortex grain inside there. What's different about the Vortex grain? It's a special type of aggregate or agglomerate type grain, aluminium oxide, but it's the way it's formed makes this disc very powerful. It's got lots of cutting surfaces on this grain. This is what gives it the edge. So we take many small bites of the material whilst being able to give it a really nice finish. So that's the product we're going to use today for blending and refining on step two. If you could pop the slide up there, please, Martin. So step two, blending and refining. So what products we can use? We went through that. We had a look at the flat disc and the surface conditioning disc, but we opted for the Vortex Rapid Blend T27. What is unitized material? I'll come into that when we come back on camera. Reducing process steps with Vortex technology. This is one of the key things about this Vortex product, is it's able to take the scratch from a P80 flap or fiber disc and give you a much better finish than you would get from using, you know, the next grade in a conventional abrasive. So we can skip two or three steps by using the unitized Vortex because of its finishing capability, and avoiding burn and a consistent finish. Again, unitized does not change as it wears like a coated abrasive, so you get a consistent finish as you go through. And we do have inside this product our smear-free resin in here, so this is why we can avoid burning on the material or any smear. Okay, so unitized material, you may have come across it before or used it before, but you know, how is it made exactly? What actually is it? Well, it is actually made out of hand pad material, surprisingly. So, you know, your common hand pad that you see out in the market, a little bit like the one you use at your home and the kitchen sink a little bit, but this one has obviously abrasive grains impregnated inside, so don't do the dishes with it. It is essentially the same material in here. So it's this material, layers and layers of this material, actually compressed with resin and grain to give us this basically big sandwich of material. So this is essentially what we have in here: many layers of hand pad material, making this this solid unitized material. We can get different densities, as we will see later on. This is a density 5, which means it has a certain amount of laminations in there and a certain amount of resin in there to give it the density. And later we'll be looking at a density 2, which has less laminations of hand pad material and less strong resin bond structure in there as well. Okay, so the reason I like this is because whilst it's quite hard, it's still kind of flexible, so it'll still adapt to the shape of this letter and be able to remove all of this quite bad damage that's on the surface with the Vortex. So no chance of gouging. So even if I run over the edge, if I did that with a fiber disc that I was using earlier, it would create quite a bad impression on the edge, which would be difficult to repair. with this product, if I go over the edge, it just blends and makes it look good. So there's no risk when you use a product like this. And remember, at this stage, this component is quite valuable already. There's already, you know, it's already been cut off the tube, it's been welded. There's lots of processes gone in to get to this far. So if we make a mistake now, that costs some money. So it's kind of safest product to use. That's why I particularly like it. Right, we can use it on the same tool as we used the fibre disc earlier. No problem with maximum speed. The speed of this product's rated to 12,000 RPM. We're using it on an 11,000 RPM grinder, so no issue with that. As we said this morning, sometimes it's better with non-woven kind of products that we can turn the speed of the machine down a little bit to just to, you know, create less friction. But as we are only here for a short session, I'm going to keep the machine on full speed and just keep make sure I move around the surface rather than dwelling in case I get any burn on there. Right, so let's mount the tool. Get him on there. Not easy with these gloves on. Okay, we're in, we're locked in. Let's turn the power back on. Always remember as well, guys and girls, to turn the power off to your machine when you're changing the disc, because you have your hands on the abrasive. If you slip and turn it on by mistake, yeah, it could be nasty. So always remember to turn your power off before you start changing the disc. And always remember to turn it back on when you try to use it, because I forget that quite a lot, to be honest with you. All the time, yeah. Right, okay, so again, this may take a little bit of time. I'm really going to pay some attention to this now on the surface and get all of these scratches out. I'm even going to try with the grinder disc scratches, but we'll see about that. Okay, Robin, if you wouldn't mind, that would be great. Thank you.
Okay, so once again, the benefit of this disc is the compact, durable structure that you can see applying to the surface now, but this gives a combination of still a little bit of flexibility, but you know, a compact durableness that you can't get with other discs, and it's really getting hugging the surface. The contact area spreads wider. And the benefit of the Vortex grain that Paul mentioned, it's our favorite grain for non-woven abrasives, because you get a little bit of cut from it, but also combined with the ability to deliver an excellent finish, and much more than any other product in the market can do. Again, here you can see that little bit of cut in there, taking off the 10% of the weld that Paul had left over from the previous step. So just in harmony with what we did earlier with the first step, this disc is really working hard to eliminate anything, any defects, any surface layers, but also at the same time and in the same action, that's really important, in the same action, it's delivering a fantastic finish. Again, the versatility of this disc can be used for deburring. You'll see that probably later in this section, but edge radiusing, and a wide variety of other applications too. The product is available not only in angle grinder discs, but also in wheels, large wheels, small wheels, and even also in small mounted points in order to access small, intricate or difficult to access areas. So again, already you can see the benefit of this disc is the fantastic finish that it's delivering. But you can see it's still got a bit of cutting power. You can see the spark coming from the disc itself. Now Paul's doing on the edges here, which is difficult to us. We don't want to gouge in or damage the geometry of the component, but it's working perfectly just to give a slight radius on there. And again, without any sacrifice on the finish level. So this disc has the ability really to speed up your processes. And again, as Paul mentioned, you can take two or three steps out of your process just using this. Here you can see a real close-up view on the benefits of this disc. Remember the technique from Paul here, it's slow and deliberate, no need to rush across the surface that may cause a little bit of damage.
Yeah, so I don't know whether I couldn't quite hear you there, Robin, on that one, but I'm not sure whether you were stating about the fact of the versatility of this product as well, the fact I can run over the edges here and you know, take off any sharp corners there, and the weld that seam that was on here, take it away. I can even finish the top section of one of these as well and take off the weld burn, as you can see here. So I went over there. Oh, sorry, the camera angle. I went over there and took off all the burn on that part as well in the weld. So you could use it all over the product without having to switch back to, you know, a coated abrasive or anything like that. If it's small areas of weld like this, the Vortex will do it no problem. Conventional welds, no. Don't use the Vortex on that. There's much better products in the market for taking the weld off. So, but for edge, you know, deburring and blending, as you see, it's perfect. So I spent a little bit of time on there, to be honest with you guys. I could see quite a few pinholes in the surface of this. Once we start blending it down, all the pinholes from the, you know, the rolling process become very, very evident, and they don't look very nice. And if we're taking it to polish, we need to get rid of those. So that's why it takes a little bit of time. But I spent a long time dwelling on this part. It's very hot already. I can feel it, you know, the heat coming through my gloves, but no smear. Okay. You pick up any of the product you can find in the market that's not from Norton, and I can guarantee you will see smear on your stainless steel at this temperature. It will leave black lines everywhere. On here, there are none. Okay. So,
Paul, just to explain what smear is. So smear is when that product starts to heat up, the resin and the fibers of the product start to melt, and they deposit themselves as a glue-like substance onto the surface of the metal component, and that kind of shows up as a black mark or smearing, as it's known in the trade.
Yeah. And can, you know, if you smear your disc on there, you have to take that smear off. So it's something more to do. It's another process. So if you can avoid that, please do so. Make your life much easier. Okay, so we can now move on to step 3 or 4. So we're halfway through. We've taken the weld off. We've blended the surface pretty nice, to be honest with you. That's probably good enough for most people as a finished product. But we want to take it a little bit further. Okay, so the next step we're doing is what we call finishing. Thank you for the slide there, Martin. So finishing, as a lot of these stages, again, is another critical stage. It's difficult. It really is as simple as that. I'm not trying to make myself look smart, because I'm not, but finishing is really hard. It's a specialist job most of the time. So the products of finishing we'll go through in a little moment, and why I'm choosing a soft grader product in silicon carbide we'll talk about as well. But if we come back to me, Martin, what's really difficult with finishing is the risk factor. I was talking earlier about, you know, the amount of money in this component now. It's a valuable item after all the hours that's been this has been worked on. Again, each stage we go to, it increases the value of this. So this is why finishing is such a crucial stage. If we make a mistake here, it's going to cost us much more to rebuild this component from scratch or rework this component. Okay, so this is why we say finishing is really, really critical. So for this stage, again, we've got a few choices. It comes down to the same choices we showed this morning again, but we're just focusing a little bit more on these products than we did in this morning session. It's, you know, the fine graded products are what we're looking at now. Again, we could use a surface conditioning disc. All right, no problem with using one of those, cheap and cheerful again. Or we can use its brother, the surface conditioning flap disc that we have here. Again, pieces of this material attached around a fiberglass core. Basically a long life version of this product, and again 10 times the life, so very possible choice. It's also angled at 15 degrees, so it's nice to use on an angle grinder, which is a natural angle to grind at as well. But again, as I'm asked to use what I want to use and my favorites, I will stick to the unitized material. So I'll stick to our rapid blend material here, which is our 2SF material. This is a little bit different than the blue Vortex material I was showing you earlier. We don't really need Vortex anymore. We're not trying to cut material. We're trying to get and impart a very nice finish on there. Like I said, this product was 2SF. 2 stands for the density. 2 is our softest product that we have available from Norton, and it is quite pliable. You can put your thumb into this product with not too much pressure. It's silicon carbide on here, inside this disc, just a standard silicon carbide grain. A silicon carbide on stainless steel will give us a much brighter finish than the aluminium oxide. So say if I finished with this versus this, you'll see that this product gives us a much brighter finish, while this will give us a quite very bright but matte effect with aluminium oxide due to the blocky grain we have in aluminium oxide, whereas the sharp grain in silicon carbide will give us that almost a blue tinge, a real sort of bright finish to the product. Okay, so let's get this on the grinder. Again, we could talk a little bit about speed here. I think we probably reduce the speed a little bit now, because I don't want to put so much heat into this product. I can already see when I touch the metal with my gloves, it's melting part of my gloves onto the surface. So I already know this is pretty warm. So I'm going to use a different grinder now. I'm going to use a variable speed grinder that we have here. Same manufacturer, same quality of tool, just that the fact it's a bit lower power and it's got a variator on the back, so I can turn the speed down a little bit. Speed equals friction equals heat. It's really simple. So if we can avoid putting so much heat into the material, it's going to do me a favor, because I will spend a little bit more time than I did with the blue disc on here to get this to a good finish before we polish. Not going to remove much material, but it's just about giving us that right surface aspect. Speed wise, maximum is 6. I'm going to keep this at about 3, which should be around about 7,000 RPM, roughly on that one without reading the label. Okay, so everything's in. Earpiece is on again. Okay, Robin, over to you, my friend. Bauer. I'd have to do it at some point. No, I've never done that before, Robin. Okay, so off we go.
Yeah, as Paul explained, you really get the wow factor from this particular product because of the use of the silicon carbide grain here. And again, it's probably one of the softest of our unitized rapid blend range. But again, you have that effect, and this is a great camera angle to see it, where it wraps around the surface of the component that you're working on, delivering, as Paul mentioned, the silicon carbide grain here, delivering a really bright, shiny finish in comparison to a similar product that would contain aluminium oxide. So we're seeing all the benefits of this third step in the process. Again, you can see with this angle the wraparound effect of the softness of the unitized structure. Again, it's durable. It's durable enough to do deburring, but still compact and a degree of flexibility about the product, giving that wraparound effect. Again, this product can also be used in a wide variety of different applications in terms of edge radiusing, deburring, but certainly generating a really bright surface finish on stainless steel here, as you can see, is becoming very important. Again, all of our non-woven abrasives, you tend to have a name coming from rapid blend that you're looking at right now. We've got rapid prep, rapid strip, rapid finish. So the rapid indicates how quickly you can achieve that finish, or that level of finish, within your processes. So all of the products are designed to help you achieve what you're looking for and get to that point as quickly as we possibly can. Keeping cool, not smearing, which is very important as well, because as Paul mentioned, smearing, that effect can then start to cause a bad surface that won't pass lab inspection for a wide variety of components, especially in the more technical industries, and which means rework. So no smear.
Yeah, thanks for that, Robin. I heard you talking about the rapid families there. Yeah, it's a good idea to say, you know, it applies to all of our non-woven products. Oof, that's warm. Don't put your arm on there. As you can see by the disc on here as well, you know, I've spent a long time dwelling on the surface here. But if we just have a quick close-up of the disc, if we can, Martin. There's hardly any anywhere on the surface of this disc. You know, we've used that for quite some time. I did say it was a soft graded material or two density, but you know, I've used it on here over the edges and everything else, and still there's plenty of flow. Well, it's hardly touched, to be honest with you. So you can see the kind of lifetime you get out of this product is pretty damn good for what it does. All right. Right, let's take the power off because I need to change over to our next product and step four, which is our final step, everybody, which is marvelous, and we're doing good for time. I think we've got 18 minutes before we finish, so be enough time to get the polish and then go to questions and answers at the end. So yes, step four is our polishing stage, and really there's not so much choice in any abrasive manufacturer's range for polishing. We're very much the same as that. We're using felt, okay, so non-abrasive material for our disc. Tool speed awareness for this one is critical, and I'll show you why, and the compound choice here is the next critical stage of this one as well. Okay, so let's get rid of the 2SF back over and tidy up a little bit. So let's bring over what we call our Norton Rapid Polish product. Again, this is a T27 shape, or T29 shape. This one it's actually got a contour on it, or a shape, so about a 15 degree angle on here. And this is essentially the same as a flap disc, an abrasive flap disc, but instead of abrasive flaps, we have a non-abrasive felt material. Okay, so what we said about speed. Okay, so on here, we have to pay attention to this. It's got a maximum speed of 8,500 RPM. So we cannot use that disc on a conventional grinder that has no variation. Otherwise, you know, it's never going to kill you. It's just made out of felt flaps, but you're just going to end up with a room full of white fluff, like you've been having a pillow fight in there or something. So it's not ideal. Okay, so try and pay attention to the fact it is a lower speed disc to use. So you must use this disc on the machine with speed variation. To get the best effect with it on its own, it will do very little. So we really need to use it with some compound. And today I'm going to be using the white compound, which is particularly good for polishing stainless steel, which is exactly what we're doing. So quite handy, really. So I'm going to put some compound onto this surface of here because it's quite hot. So we can melt a bit of compound on there because the more compound, the better. And also, I'm going to load some compound on the disc while we've got it on the grinder, reduce the speed really down, and we can fill these flaps full of compound too. Right, let's get it on the grinder. Make sure we choose the one with the variator. Yep, we have the disc on there. Lock the nut on it, and then we'll see if we can get to the hey presto phase where I can be proud of what I've done. It's not easy, this application, I have to say. To get it right, it's not so easy with a tool like an angle grinder, but very possible. Right, so I'm going to now put a compound onto the disc. So I've turned the speed down, so I'm not going to be out of control. I'm just simply going to offer the compound up to this disc and load up these flats with it. When you do this, try and keep it so the disc is rotating away from you, so all of the spray of the compound is going away, because otherwise you end up covered in this stuff, and it's uh it's not very nice, it sticks everywhere. If there's also somebody you don't particularly like in the room, it's quite handy to point it at them as well and cover them in it for a bit of a giggle. But Martin's over there is too far to reach at the moment. I'm sorry about that. So let's load it up and start polishing. When you do polish, if you go slow and steady, you will see all of the lines where you took with the polishing disc. So let's go nice and quick and really get this polish working into the surface. Okay, let's load him up and I can get some cables out of my feet.
Don't forget the power.
I didn't, Robin. I was testing it to see if you noticed that I forgot the power again. Okay, let's load him up.
And again, just to remind everybody, very important to slow the machine down. These discs are working at a much slower speed, variable speed, actually required here. But we get working safely on this one. You can see again the technique, Paul speed it up, as he mentioned he would do, and that's starting to generate that right level of finish that he showed in the before the start. So we should even be able to see his face reflected in this surface, which may or may not be a good thing as far as you're concerned. After we finish with this, the felt polishing disc, we'll give this a quick wipe and you'll be able to see the level of the reflection. And remember again that we just started off with this component with welds on there, so we've gone inside four simple steps to generate a mirror-like finish, which is quite remarkable. And again, one of the ideas behind these live stream demonstrations is to show you how to achieve that with the benefit of these time-saving and problem-solving products.
Now then, so I can see my face in it, right, Robin? Yeah, let's see it. I think, to be honest, it's not looking too bad. As you can see, it's there. I think we have the right level of polish on there. You can see the reflection of the desk and etc. in front of us. It's pretty similar to the one we started with. In fact, it's probably a little bit better. So you can see you really do get an idea of the reflection quality of this. Of course, it's never going to be as flat as finishing with, you know, a belt machine or something, like a dedicated polishing machine, or taking this component to a polishing wheel. That is very difficult, but you know, these are dedicated tools for the applications. But if you're a fabricator and you need to get some small parts of stainless steel to a mirror finish like this, it shows it's easily achievable with a tool that's meant for lumping off great bits of metal. Okay, this is a, you know, a very versatile tool, but it's really very designed for cutting and grinding. But we've just shown here it can be used for blending, finishing, and refining to a polish. So pretty nice application there. So not a bad result at all. If we just have a quick look on the end of the material here, if we go back to the close up there, Martin, here's where we gave a little grind with the grinding disc. So this shows you what can happen if you go wrong on step one. Okay, a lot of damage there. To be able to take that out, I'm going to have to use, you know, flap discs or fiber discs and take away a lot of that material to rectify that. It's a mess. So not really, it really is something you want to avoid from the very beginning, to not do that. Okay. Right. I think looking at the time, we've got 10 minutes left before the end of the session. So just for you to know, Norton is here to help you. Help is at hand. If you'd like to see some of the products or like to have more of a direct demonstration or trial of some of the products you've seen today, contact your local Norton representative in your respective countries, and I'm sure they'll be happy to to help you, you know, have a test, take them into a factory and see how we go on stainless steel. Certainly some products here that are very very interesting to anybody. Okay, so for the people who are watching this live stream on recorded, because we are recording this for viewback later on our YouTube channel, this will be the end. Thank you for your attendance. For those that are watching live with us right now, thanks for staying on. We can now go onto our questions and answers session. Thank you.